Thank you for coming, Kent.
Yeah. Well, when I saw how many people hadn't seen it, that explained why there are so many of you here. No, all kidding aside, I've never made it a secret of the fact that this isn't one of my personal favorites, but it's got a huge fan base, and people would always say, when's it coming out on DVD? And I would say, hopefully never. But here it is. So when Joe Rubin called me and said that Vinegar Syndrome was going to release it, then I said, well, then, you know, if it's coming out anyway, I'm going to jump on board and do as much as I can to make sure it's good for the fans. So what you're going to see is we had to make cuts to get our R rating and get into theaters. So this is the first time, only the second time. We screened this print once before. It's my own personal. It was my own personal print. It's the only print in existence that isn't cut. It's the unrated cut. And that's what Vinegar Syndrome has now got on Blu-ray, is my uncut version that has about a minute and a half more of blood and gore. Yeah. He's trying to tell you about paranormal and all that stuff. All you need to know is it's got blood, boobs, and ghosts. So, what more? I mean, wholesome family entertainment. And I hope you like cheese, because there is a really nice pizza-like cheesy spread over the whole thing. Afterwards, we'll have a Q&A. I'll be here with my co-producer, Dan Duncan. It was the first film we produced together. We've done, I think, three films since. And Hal Havins is in this, who played Stooge in Night of the Demons, which I'm assuming more of you have seen than this. So, enjoy, and we'll all be shuffling in. We were having dinner, and they're a little late with our checks, so I ran over to intro the film. And
here we go.
Thanks, Jim.
No problem, Kevin.
Okay, and we'll talk afterwards.
Yep. Q&A.
I have Dan Duncan, my co-producer, and the one and only Hal Havins, Elwin, the groundskeeper. Also known as Stooge and Night of the Demons. So,
I guess we'll start with the elephant in the room. Something happened to the sound on this film.
Yes.
Yeah. So.
Well, actually, this was a very low budget. It was like $400,000, which sounds like a lot now when people can shoot digital. But back then, you had to shoot 35, as you saw. It was 35 millimeter. It was SAG. We had the IATSE projectionists union. Otherwise, it couldn't have played in theaters. So that all had to be paid for, and there were a lot of fixed costs. Film developing, all that was fixed. So $400,000 back then was really, really super cheap.
Yeah.
And I hired a lot of people who I was giving, I mean, we had Hal, who was actually a professional actor, and Linnea, and Quinn had been in a couple of movies, as had the lead actress, but otherwise a lot of them were people who had been in my student films in college, and I wanted to give them to reward them, say thank you for being in my student films and put them in a feature. And I also did that with some of the other people in crew positions. Maybe they'd been assistants and we bumped them up to first chair, so to speak. And the sound gal, unfortunately, it was her first time. And whereas most people rose to the challenge, she kind of dropped the ball. And the whole film, sound was gone.
Yeah.
The whole film is dubbed. There's not a single sound, footstep, voice, background, door creak, anything that is production sound. The whole film was dubbed 100%. Might as well have been shot in another language or shot silent. That's why the dialogue's so clean and crisp, though. Because they were all speaking into a mic in a sound booth. So
there's a credit that says it was recorded in stereo, but it sounded like mono. What we heard sounded like mono.
Yeah, it was recorded in stereo. I don't know if that's because, I don't know.
I think it'll probably run through 5.1 mix.
Okay, maybe. Yeah, no, it was definitely, it was a stereo mix.
The center channel was pretty booming. So.
Yeah, yeah.
I like the classic, porn stuff.
The classic what?
The classic porn music.
Oh, yeah. You like that?
I like that.
Okay,
yeah.
That's very good.
That was really hot.
Yeah.
I can do that.
Yes.
May I ask?
No,
please,
not
please
you.
Do that.
Not me.
Okay. Well,
Kevin!
Just a movie.
How did you do that?
Do what?
The really sexy hot shit.
The sexy hot shit?
The girl who's like all of the classical music.
Well, Dennis just did the score.
Huh? That's just
my
it?
Brother Dennis did the score, yeah.
And that was it? There was no motivation, no like, hey, I'm waiting this thing over you?
Yeah, it was, I need music here. Yeah.
Okay, so me, the one who's done underpaid
yeah.
work for you.
Yeah. Join the ranks, baby.
Join the ranks. No, but really, I would really be interested to see how you have a creative development process. Both of you. Is it, do you have something that, I mean, I know I could call you on the phone, but.
Right.
No, but I think.
No, I appreciate what you're saying. Others might want to hear.
Is what do you see as some of the staple points of what you see as creative development in your process?
You want to take this one? This is our first film. This was the first film we produced together. We then did. Brain Dead's the only other one we produced.
But
I thought we did three.
But then we worked together.
Well,
one.
Dan's
well,
been my editor almost every film I've done. But
yeah.
This was the first thing we produced together. Then about 7 or 8 years ago, we produced Brain Dead together, which was similar.
So,
it was blood and gore and a lot of comedy. So
don't you think that blonde in the shower looked a lot like Kellyanne Conway?
Oh.
No.
She looked a lot like trash. She looked
the
a lot
Trump
like trash.
Oh, yeah, Linnea, I don't know. Do you think?
Trash.
I think she's a lot prettier than Kellyanne.
She
is.
She looks just like trash.
Yeah.
Well, what we like to do to her.
We did have a camera in the shower, though, so, you know, no microwave, but the camera was there in the shower. So, yeah, no, it'd be hard to homage you back in 1989. So the question was the creative process.
Was the staples of your creative process, and is there something that you change every? And this is also a teaser. Some of the staples that you have every time you create a new project.
Don't look at me.
Yeah,
I
it's
just
you know.
In a week.
Am I going to get paid this time? No, it's. I do believe that if your hero makes people laugh, they will pretty much be on board with him. Because I find that true in real life. People tend to like people they find amusing.
They don't like people, they like people.
They like people. They like them if they're amusing. So I try to make, usually,
they don't like Smith and correct you too much.
Yeah. Okay. Well, the part I had you in mind for is going to someone else now. I find that humor is funnier if you've been scared, and then the scares are scarier if you were just laughing. So I try to do a good amount, equal mix when I'm doing something like this, or Brain Dead, or even Witchboard, or Night of the Demons for that matter. A lot of humor with the horror. So I do, that's probably a staple I have often when I'm doing
anything.
Where
was that house, that mansion?
I'm sorry?
Where was that mansion?
Fairfield.
Fairfield, California. It's an actual mansion called the Stone Dean Mansion. It's like built in 1865. They brought it over stone by stone from England. It was like 10,000 square feet.
Filled with antiques.
The woman who lived in the house, we just knocked on the door. We saw it. We knocked on the door. I said,
and
we'd be interested
in
shooting a
yeah.
film. She said, come on in. it's a big, different experience when you're not shooting in L.A. She said, you want to shoot a movie here? We said, yeah. I said, we don't have a lot of money. We could maybe only pay you $500 a week. And she was like, oh, you're going to pay us too? It was like, I wish I hadn't said that now, but yeah, I guess we are. And she was an antique She had, you know, she sold and bought antiques,
yeah.
So everything in that house was there already, which is good, because we had like a $10 for our production budget design. And while we were walking around, she said, oh, this carpet you're standing on is a Chinese, it's about 10 grand. And we all
no,
went,
no, it was 100,000.
Oh, and we all went like, oh! And she goes, no, it's a carpet you're supposed to walk
yeah.
on. Obviously, you've never had a film crew in your house, but okay. So anyway, everything in there was real. It was an antique, it was all... We brought in a few things, like we built the chapel with the altar and all, but all the furniture in the house was already there, which was great. So we got this great production design for no money, because that's how much we had.
Had a great
time. Yeah.
It's not a question, I just wanted to say I love the one-liners and the editing, and I thought the star was great.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Where did the idea for this film come from? Because you did Witchboard previously. Correct?
Right, I'd done Witchboard and Night of the Demons, and I believe I... Had I done The Cellar, or did I do The Cellar right after this?
Right, yeah,
I am. Oh, you know what? I think we were getting ready to do this, and then I got offered The Cellar. I said, oh, this one's paying me, so I'm going to go do that, and then I'll come back and we'll do Witchboard, I think was what it was.
Witchtrap,
or as it was called at the time, The Haunted. And then The Presence, and then the distributor bought it and said, which, by then, Witchboard had come out was a big hit, so he said, we're going to call this Witchtrap, because you've got the same killer, which basically we had, because he was the still photographer on Witchboard. And we said, hey, if we hire him and pay him weekly, we can pay him as a still photographer when he's not acting,
actor.
And as an actor when he's not doing the still photography. Mm-hmm. So we just had to pay him one time for two jobs. So hey, low budget, man, you got to be creative. So and then Hal, I knew, of course, from Night of the Demons. He and Linnea were, yes, no, seriously. I loved working with him. I loved working with Linnea. I actually loved working with the whole cast of Night of the Demons, but I knew when I wrote these parts, Linnea would be perfect for Ginger and Hal would be perfect for Elwin. So, Elwin, you got lucky, because I think Elwin only has four lines, so he was about 10 minutes in the ADR booth doing his dialogue, and he was out. Everyone else.
Which
was,
is why I don't remember any of this.
I know, I always feel bad, because one of the... The main criticism when the film gets criticized is that some of the performances are stilted, and it's like, yeah, because they had to come in and try to match the performance while syncing up to their original dialogue, and because we had no money and never had that in a contingency.
One day.
At the two leads got a day apiece to do their entire role, so the entire movie, Jim and Kathleen had one day, and then everyone who was a supporting player had half a day or less to do their entire role in the film. So the fact that they got any performance, I think they get a bad rap, because nobody knows that it was basically the sound that screwed everyone. So
yeah, the original sound was brilliant.
It was the performance. Elwin was Oscar worthy before he had to come in and do ADR. You know.
Seriously, that screwed the pooch.
So there was a disclaimer at the beginning, at least the VHS of Witchtrap. Was that a legal reason, or?
Well, because once the distributor bought the film and changed the title to Witchtrap, which I always hated the title, I thought it was stupid, but I knew what they were cashing. And then they made a poster that looked very similar to Witchboard. Of course, the guys who had produced and financed Witchboard went after them, and so they finally agreed to put up the disclaimer. So it was on the back of the box, and it's at the start of the film on the Laserdisc in the video. Warning, this is not a sequel to Witchboard. Yeah, okay. Which, fine, I don't care. I know they called and yelled at me, and I said, hey, I'm with you. I hate the title, but, you know, once they buy your film, they can retitle it, and you have nothing to say about it. So.
You should make that into a T-shirt.
Yeah, what? Not a sequel to Witchboard? Yeah, you know, maybe it would have sold back then. Who knows? But I got my official Witchtrap coat on here. You know. The distributors made for... Actually, they didn't make them for the crew. They made them for themselves. I found this one on eBay. So I said, I'm going to buy that because I'm the fucking director. I should get a fucking coat. But I got to tell you, I know I came in and gave you the whole disclaimer up front. I hadn't seen it in a while. I actually like it better than I thought. It was better than I remembered, you know. But I had such a low bar you had to jump over, so. Yeah.
Can I ask you about your role in the movie? Was that originally intended for somebody else?
It was intended for somebody else. One of the guys who ran the company that raised the money wanted to be an actor. And I agreed that he could have the part if he did it for free. And he flew himself up to where we were shooting for free, which he agreed. And then what, a day or two before that,
before
we were gonna shoot, he calls, he's got a big investor meeting in Chicago or something, and he's gonna go do that. Now, we have no money to one, hire an actor.
And no time.
And no time, yeah. No, and as you know, the guy, the character has all this massive exposition. So we're like, what are we going to do? And Dan says, well, you wrote it. You know it. You should do it.
And you're cheap.
And you're cheap. Yeah, yeah. Cheap and easy. So, I agreed to. It sounded like a good idea at the time. And then, you know, I saw the dailies and I realized that they're, you know, you get what you pay for.
You were very good and I'm glad.
Oh, well, thank you. You are, like, incredibly kind, and I don't buy it for a second. But I tell you, though, if I was going to give myself a cameo, I would not give myself the guy who has to explain everything, because that's the hardest part for anybody, even the most established actor, the worst role. Like, I always say that Philip in Night of the Demons had the hardest part, because he was the guy who was telling you all the history of the house. Any guy who we used to call in writing class at USC, Morris the Explainer, is the guy who explains shit, because anyone who carries exposition.
That's always my favorite character in horror films, because they always go to them in horror films. you don't have time to develop it, you know.
Right. So.
So they always pick one person that knows everything about the town, or everything, specifically everything about what goes on underground about the town. And you can always see them lining up for it too, because they take that moment, that pause, and that breath. In 19. It goes on for 10 minutes.
I should have been Elwin, and I should have let him be Morris the Explainer.
Yeah,
fuck me.
Yeah, I know.
Sorry, my favorite character. Every time you see somebody wind
thinking.
Up in a horror film, I get happy.
If I had, if they'd given me a week, I might have thought of that. Next time, you're Morris the Explainer.
If you had a week, you would have done it right.
Yeah.
I thought you handled it great. Actually,
I could have had a week. I still would have done it.
No, I'm seriously. I thought you handled it fine. That's a mouthful.
Yeah. How was it for you working on a film like this?
I don't remember it. I think it's fine.
I know. I do remember it, drinking a lot at the bar. Yeah. And
here's what I remember: getting shot in the back in those stupid cups.
Oh, the squibs.
Yeah, they were big squibs because they wanted a big blood pack.
Yeah.
He wanted a big blood pack. So they were like this big, the packs. They were huge. They were in Ziploc bags. I mean, usually they're in little cellophane, you know, these were in bags. And the cups were about that big. And they're like hard plastic cups that they put the explosive in so it doesn't blow you up. What I learned the hard way was that cup has to be affixed to your body. Because if it's not, there's a window in there. And when it blows up, it hits you. I thought I was on fire. They hit me so hard. I thought they broke and I was burning. So I was laying on the ground just waiting for cut. I'm like, I'm on fire. I'm on fire. Finally, he says cut. And I'm like screaming. I yank off my shirt, which, like, it was desperate times because I don't take my shirt off for her. And lo and behold, I wasn't on fire, but I had these two big black circles on my back for a couple months. We all suffer. Fat guy suffers more, trust me. You see what happened to Jim Quinn? Jim is beaten up by demons and people shooting at him.
Jim did
all
his own
stunts.
All
he does is look prettier and cooler. Fat guy got like 11 holes in him. That's the way it works.
That's why he's a leading man.
Exactly.
Because the more you beat him up, the better looking he becomes.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, paint it.
Yeah, it's all the makeup.
He must have been in a fight. He's prettier.
And this is Dan's first time producing. Dan had been my editor on Witchboard and the Demons. And then we decided we'd gone to film school together, and we'd been talking about how after I had done three professional films, I kind of missed the camaraderie and the fact that you did everything on a student film. Once you're on a professional film set, the director's not allowed to touch the lights or anything. It's all, you know. So we said, I'd kind of like to do that again. And we had a third friend who we went to film, who was going to write the script. And while he was writing it, and it was about a bunch of people trapped in a cabin with a giant spider outside, we got the funding. But the funding window, it was like coming to the end of the year or something, a financial quarter. Yeah. So the people who wanted finance, they had to have a movie now, and our friend was a very slow writer. So I came up with the idea for this story in one day and wrote the screenplay in 6 days. Yeah, that's why, that's why it's so Oscar worthy. It's a 6-day script.
Yeah.
And then I think we prepped it in 3 weeks Yeah. And we were up in Northern California shooting.
Shot in 18 days.
Yeah, 18-day shoot, right. And so it was my first time being a producer as well as writer director. Dan was a co-producer, and I always felt like I kind of let the direction down a little because I was focusing more on producing, but actually there were some nice shots in here.
I think you were all over that,
yeah. Well, Tommy Jewett, our DP, did a great job.
When she was asking about your creative process.
Oh, that's right.
Your creative process is in the production, in the physical production.
Yeah.
You know, you're all about shots and camera and movement.
Yeah, that's true. I do.
Have this signature.
I do believe film is first and foremost a visual medium, so you want to be visual when you're making your movie.
Yeah, you got the sense of movement and everything.
Yeah.
Everything's always moving. It's really cool.
Naked stuff.
Here's an interesting thing, though, is that there are three scenes in there that were added later.
Yeah.
Because after we shot the film, it was supposed to be short, sweet, and just, we found out that the guys who financed it had pre-sold it to a distributor. But one of the things they signed with their contract with the distributor was that they would deliver a 90-minute film,
and
we had made this great 80-minute movie.
Yeah.
So the very long dialogue scene in the bar
scene,
because then we had no money, so we had to shoot only dialogue scenes. So there was a restaurant down the street that we ate at lunch all the time, and so the guy said when we fed the crew, we ordered the food from him there, he would let us shoot for free, right?
Yeah.
So the dialogue scene in the bar,
the bathroom,
the bathroom between the husband and wife.
And that was in our office.
We built two walls in our office to resent, since they'd never been in the bathroom in the house, and we just made them pink because the bathrooms were pink in the house. And we shot that, and then the whole thing on the phone at the end was, originally they just drive off, and they say something about how are we going to explain it to the police, and he goes, I don't know, but I'm pretty sure I won't get out of prison till after I can comb my hair with a towel or something like that, and then that was the end, but then we added the whole thing on the phone.
What scenes were the scenes that were added back in with the extra gore?
The shower head, we were allowed to show it go in, but we couldn't show it come out and leave the big gaping hole. He only shoots Elwin a couple of times. He doesn't like completely empty the gun into him. The head explosion,
few
we had to cut about four frames off of that. There was one other one, I can't remember.
Not to dissolve into the skeleton?
No, they were okay with that. Yeah, they were fine with that. I'm always surprised. The Night of the Demons, I was really worried about the nipple lipstick, and they had no problem with that, but then they wanted had other stuff that was real that I'd seen in other horror films, and they wanted that cut. So I give up on the MPAA. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I gotta say, the end where that character who was, you know, all the snide remarks and everything, and then piggybacking on the scene where he's saying I don't believe in all of this.
Right.
Honest politicians, and for it to end like that. When he's at the desk and he's struggling, I thought
Oh, thank you. Well, yeah, once I realized we had to add, I mean, once I knew we had to add the scenes, I thought, well, where can I put scenes and actually maybe delve more into, for lack of a better word, subtext. Yeah, character subtext. You know, that shit we don't usually deal with. And so, yeah, so that was I thought, nice. I agree with you. I actually, as we were watching it, I thought, you know what, I kind of like this ending, actually. I got to say, I haven't seen it in a while. And, I kind of like the bar scene now too, you know, which I hated when I had to write them and we had to shoot them because I felt, oh my God, there's long dialogue scenes that we just have to stick in here at filler. The movie was moving so fast and now we got to slow it down. But I kind of like it now, so yeah, again. I had a low bar to stick over.
Yeah. And we paid for the reshoots ourselves.
Oh, yeah.
So we lost money on
yes,
the movie.
Yes, we did. Yeah. So yeah. To add insult to injury, the last little bit of money we had that we were going to pay our salaries with, we had to use for the reshoots.
Yeah, and they were going to reimburse us.
Yeah.
Never
did. Yeah.
Remember that.
Yes. You know how they say, fuck you in Hollywood, trust me. The honest people in Hollywood stab you
somebody
in the front.
Somebody made money.
Yeah. Oh yeah, somebody made money, but it wasn't us.
Yeah, it was
somebody
us.
Made money off of Witchtrap.
Yeah.
Somebody's probably still making money off of Witchtrap,
yeah.
But it ain't us. But you know what? I gotta say, it was one of the best times I ever had making a movie, and
it's
I think
fun.
It was because, in spite of all the problems we had, because it was such a low budget film, and because they were just happy we were doing a low budget film for them, they completely left us alone, and so it was kind of like making a student
and we
film.
With
well, that's
that
my point.
It.
We worked with
yeah.
friends. We worked with our crew was a very small crew. I think it was a whole crew. It was like a 4-man crew, but they were all union guys out of San Francisco who our DP had worked with before, and they just wanted to work on it. So they came and worked for what we were paying, and they were just a great crew because they were like this. You know, each one of them had like 20 years experience.
Yeah, eating commercials.
Yeah, doing
yeah.
commercials and stuff. Yeah.
How much distribution did you get? And
ancillary
rights. And
well, I'll tell you, we got a lot more than we thought. We kind of made this just for us, really. And back then, a film that wasn't a studio film maybe sold 10,000 video cassettes. And that was good for a low-budget film. And this ended up selling like 25, 30,000. And it actually got a limited theatrical.
Yeah, and it was 1.6 million.
In video sales, yeah, for a $400,000 movie.
Yeah.
So, you know, it made over three times its budget back.
It's kind of like Titanic.
Yeah.
Yeah, really.
There were many times on set I felt like I was hitting an iceberg. So, and we were sinking fast.
But there was a lot of Mountain Dew.
A lot of Mountain Dew.
Oh, yeah.
That was 90%
of our budget. The first day you walked on and said, where's the Mountain Dew? And we had to run and get it.
Oh, that's right, because I can't direct without Mountain Dew.
Exactly.
I'm not a prima donna, but there are certain things that have to be on
so
the set.
So we cut some
it.
Production stuff
yeah.
to pay for it.
Well, damn well we should.
Yeah.
I'm a,
that's
I'm
a consistency
a,
with you, Dad.
I'm a movie mogul / horror icon, goddammit. I deserve my Mountain Dew. Yeah, I know, but we got to work on that. Anything else?
One more thing.
Okay, what, Jewel?
Oh, I really love your tire shots.
The tire shot
coming
up. Oh yeah, that was really difficult. We put the car up against the camera and backed away.
Yeah,
and
always use that.
And then reverse
the
shot.
Yeah.
All the effects were practical because CGI didn't exist back then. The bullet
Steve,
would
get back down here. Steve!
The bullet
Steve.
Would be a lot easier to do with CGI now.
I have one question over here.
Yes.
In the light. The detective with the very smart remarks was an engaging character. Have you thought about using him in something else that you're working in? And since, you know, as you said, this one maybe not had a big distribution, so... I would have never seen the character before. You considered
like giving him a spin-off,
like
another film.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know what? Yeah, this, you know, like I said, it took me years to get to the point where I kind of appreciate this movie. I was not a big fan of it when we at the time when we were done with it, because we'd had so many issues with it that I would see and cringe. I always see all the flaws in anything I do, and this one, because of the sound, I just see it as one big giant flaw for so long that I was probably unable to enjoy it as much as I enjoyed it tonight. But I've worked with Jim on a few films. He was also the buddy in Witchboard who gets crushed by the smart mouth buddy of our hero who gets mm-hmm. crushed by the sheetrock in Witchboard.
And Endangered Species.
Oh yeah, and he's in my film Endangered Species, where he's the smart alecky, pathologist. And then he was in a student film of mine where he was the smart alecky guy at the morgue.
What do you know? Night of the Demons.
Oh yeah, he's most probably best known is he does all the voices for the demons in Night of the Demons. So that's why when they're walking up to the house and the guy says, "How much do you think a place like?" And he goes, "Your very soul." And he sounds just like Angela, because he actually did do the voice of Angela in all the Night of the Demons films. So and he can just do that voice. So, yeah.
Last time we met each other was at Fangoria Weekend of Horrors when I was 13 years old.
I remember.
And what you did for me is you put me in front of Mimi and Linnea Quigley and had a picture taken of me back then. I was hoping it would be possible for us to take a picture this time, because it's been that long. And, you know, I dropped everything, including my angry wife tonight, guys, to be here. Like, when I walk in the door, I know I'm going to get yelled at. I'm just going to be like, there's a picture with me with Kevin.
I got to tell you, I'm so much more sexy than Linnea and Amelia. I don't know if the camera can handle that, but sure, yeah.
Thank you.
Is that it?
Well, we'll do the picture out of the lobby.
So. Okay.
But so if Kevin and you guys feel up to it, Joe's got a box of Witchtrap Blu-rays out there. For sale? Want to sign some?
Yeah, if you guys want to buy one, we'll sign it for you while we're here.
And about 10 minutes, we're going to be starting our surprise secret feature, so you're welcome to stay. Yeah.
It's the sequel to Witchtrap.
Witchtrap. Witchboard 4.
Yes, exactly. Witchboard. Witchboard. Not a sequel to Witchtrap.